Unmute yourself.
Good evening, friends. I'm Sujata Shankar, convener of Intact. Thanks to each of you for joining today for this talk on elephants. And welcome to each of you, the members of Intact, friends of Intact, and children of our heritage clubs. A very warm welcome and a special welcome to Dr. Sukumar. Thank you for kindly agreeing to share your wide knowledge and your experience on a subject that's very close to all of us and that all of us are interested in, whether young or old, on the largest, poorest animal walking on this planet Earth, the elephant. INTACT is an acronym for the Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, founded in 1984 to protect India's vast, unprotected heritage, whether built, natural, or intangible. In India, we are recognized as the largest heritage organization with over 200 chapters across the country. And in Chennai chapter, we've been having programs and initiatives for the last several years, almost since the inception of INTACT. And we've been having these programs on roughly a monthly basis. And of course, of late, it has been online. And we've had several programs in the recent past, some of the programs being, you know, this panel discussion by Professor A.G.K. Menon and Rajiv Bhargava on the future of the past on conservation issues. And we recently had a workshop on macrame, and we look forward today to the talk on elephants. And to those of you who are joining us new, I'd like to say that our talks are posted on Instagram and on our Facebook page. I encourage you to please look at those. And if you'd like to be on our mailing list or to become members, you can mail us at intactchennai@gmail.com. Today's talk focuses, as I said, on the elephant, which is a prodigious consumer of plants. The elephant's feeding proclivities sadly bring it often into direct conflict with people, and that results in widespread loss of agricultural crops and lives, both human and animal. Who better than Dr. Sukumar, who is known internationally for the depth of his work on the animal, to share the insights on the nuances of these issues and challenges. I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Sukumar. Raman Sukumar hails from Madras, where he did his studies and developed his early interest in the natural world. In 1979, he moved to Bangalore for doctoral studies at the Indian Institute of Sciences. He called a Vanavasi by his grandmother when he was very young. Sukumar roamed the jungles of Satyamangalam, Mudumalai, and other hills for research on elephants. His doctoral thesis on the interactions between elephants and people was eventually published as a monograph by Cambridge University Press in 1989. Sukumar is present honorary professor of ecology at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. While Sukumar is internationally known for his pioneering research on the ecology, behavior, and conservation of Asian elephants, he has also researched other subjects such as tropical forests and climate change. Excuse me. His primary conservation interests lie in promoting sustainable landscapes for elephants and biodiversity. He has lectured widely at universities and other institutions around the world and held positions at Princeton University, Columbia University, and Kyoto University in Japan. The author of four books on the elephant and over 200 scientific papers, Sukumar is the recipient of several national and international awards, the most notable being the International Cosmos Prize in Japan in 2006. He's also contributed for nearly three decades to the work of Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, that shared the Nobel Peace Prize in 2007. We're very honored to have you, Dr. Sukumar. And just a couple of instructions before we go on with Dr. Sukumar's talk. We'd request all participants to please stay on mute. And at the end of the talk, when there's a question answer session, if required, we'll ask you to unmute. Otherwise, just please continue to stay on mute. You can type your questions in the chat box, and we will take those up for asking questions after the talk is over. If you have other friends or anybody joining in after the 100 members who can join is, you know, when the talk is full here, you can request them to go on to the YouTube channel, Intact Chennai Chapter. I hope you'll all please stay on mute so that the audio experience for everyone is at its best. Thank you so much. Welcome, Dr. Sukumar, and over to you.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, Sujata, for that those very kind words of introduction. Let me put on my share my screen. Now, elephant throws rickshaws and motorcycles for the Hindu festival in India. I'm not sure if the elephant, you know, it would have been a festive mood, you know.
Sukumar, we can't see your screen.
You certainly can't see the screen now?
Yeah, we are only seeing you.
Okay. Now, let me just go back.
Oh, I can see, I don't have a problem.
Okay. Did you see the screen until the previous slide?
Until now, it is okay.
It is visible very well. It is small. Lights are visible for us. It can be seen, but it's very small. The size is very small.
No, I'm putting it full screen, so you have to talk to the people who are controlling the presentation.
No, we are able to see it full screen.
Yes, thank you. I don't have any problem.
You don't have any
problem. I'm not seeing anything. I'm only seeing Mr. Sukumar.
Yeah,
okay.
Same here.
Okay. So, I think that's a problem at your end, you know, because my laptop is working perfectly. I'm able to share a full screen with the whole audience. So that is
that's changed.
Just pin it anyway.
I'm going.
Should I pin it? Should I just and they go over to Andhra and sometimes they come back and sometimes they don't come back. So this is a very very common sight today, and sites like this are really, you know, are seen only in India. You don't see such sites in, you know, even in Africa. You don't get elephants crossing major highways like this. But you can imagine what happens. And occasionally there's an accident that takes place. A bus comes and hits an elephant at night. You know, this happens at night and so on. But this has become very common, and especially in Hosur Township, this has become very common. Now, the point I would like to emphasize is that elephant-human conflict is ancient. You know, some years ago, I was plain bread. Created, you know, outside the forest areas or inside the forest areas. So that's why, that's the reason why these elephants are going out. They're seeking out the best amount of forage and crops available for them to feed upon. So as long as crops are very abundant, they are tasty, and they will continue to lure elephants, and the conflict will continue to perpetuate. I must also tell you that in some parts of the country, elephants like Central India, and they seek, you know, stored grain, they stored salt. Elephants you know, all mammals are deficient in sodium. So, you know, if you go to a wildlife sanctuary, you will see that salt licks are there where people, the forest department will put for the tourists to see. So when people store salt inside their houses, elephants go and try to seek it out. And alcohol, you know, it's not just humans that alcohol, it's also elephants. Country-made liquor, you know, they manufacture country-made liquor and store them in barrels. The elephants can smell this out. The elephant is such a, you know, it is far more sensitive than that of a dog or a bloodhound, you know. It's the most sensitive, probably, organ of any mammal in terms of the sense of smell. It can smell to that particular house, put its trunk in, maybe demolish the wall, and actually, you know, get at that attractive drink that it wants. Lots of challenge. Narrative sometimes is that elephants have no food in the forest and therefore they come out. Yes, sometimes it can happen that elephants don't have sufficient food in the forest and therefore they are coming out. I can also tell you many instances when elephants have enough food in the forest but yet they're coming out and they are much better. This photograph was taken by my student Sanjita in Hassan district. Just look at the body condition of this elephant. Beautifully well-rounded elephant. It's an another female elephant, Bandipur National Park. You think that the elephant inside a national park, you know, will be look very healthy. Elephant outside the national park will be starving to death. Just, you know, we have screened dozens and dozens of elephants like this. Average, the body condition of elephants which come outside a national hormones. Are elephants inside the national park more stressed or less stressed compared to an elephant outside the national park? This is a on the right. You know, it's relatively bony. And an elephant outside the national park in Hassan district is much, much better. And what we actually found was the stress hormone, the glucocorticoid hormones.
Elephant biology, why elephants come and drink grass, why they come to people. It's a very, very complex issue. And of course, these male elephants, I have found 20 years ago, they take a lot more risk in coming out to raiding crops. They are 5 times more prone to raiding crops than the female elephants. Very, very simple reason. That is, you know, the male elephants come into must. You know, in Tamil, you call it madam. And must is a Urdu word for intoxication. And the elephants show this must about once a year, from a few days to a few weeks. You know, you have a secretion from a gland situated between the eye and the ear, you know, and there's a lot of chemical signaling that goes on when the elephant is in must. And the elephant is
dominant over males that are not in must.
There's actually selection, the females actually prefer to mate with the male elephants when they come.
So these male elephants are willing to take a lot of risk because potentially they get a lot of gain. The elephant is also doing a cost-benefit calculation. He is finding that if it comes out and raids crops, it is in much better body condition and it can have potentially a lot of gain to better access to females for mating. And that's when they are more likely to be associated with female elephants. So there is this wonderful picture of a male elephant in must. This is Kaziranga associating with a female elephant in this. Then you have and that is, you know, okay, I've been a professor and, you know, I teach my students. Hopefully, I teach the right thing to my students. But there are elephant professors too. And sometimes they teach the bad habits to the students. So there's a lot of learning going on. You know, these male elephants, what they do is, when they are about 15 years of home range, they are away from their natal family. And in the process, so you get these all male groups forming. So actually you get sometimes a young male associating. You see on the left, you see a young male with tusks. The backside, you see a very large male without tusks. And that's the professor. And okay, it's got tusks also, sorry. The tusks are hidden. And this professor is teaching the young male. So the young male is interning with the professor. What do you do? How do you go and rate crops? What's the kind of crops that you feed upon? You know, if you have a very hostile farmer, how do you tackle? And all these things that the young male is learning from the professor. So very, very interesting situation. And we find a lot of... And my student, Shant, and some of us, we co-authored a paper recently in a journal called Scientific Reports. All male groups in elephant, in Asian elephants. A novel adaptive social strategy in anthropology. We are creating more and more human-dominated landscapes, and the elephants are responding to novel behaviors. So you get into male groups, all male groups, which are larger in size, in terms of group size. They're able to more effectively come and crop raid. They're able to tackle the farmers more effectively. They're learning from each other. There's a lot of transmission of behavior, what I call cultural transmission of behavior, and so on. Here you have a larger class in Bangalore. This is a group of about, I think, 12 or 17 elephants, I think, over here. This is an all-male group. Now, if you look at this, this is very close to Tumkur. You look at this group, you know, you think it's a family group. It's not a family group. It's a bachelor herd, what we call a bachelor herd. All these males are all these elephants are male elephants. And they're associating, they're learning from each other. They're knowing, they're learning how to tackle farmers. And what do? You know, they evade humans in a very, very simple way. You know, you see this association that's going on. Is that these elephants during the daytime, very often, they get into a very large lake. Farmers will obviously put these elephants away from their coconut farm or banana field or whatever. So what these male elephants do, and this is a picture I took in few years ago. During the daytime, they take refuge from people in the center of the lake, stays there for 12 hours. So this is a 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. sojourn in a very large lake. And therefore, I've taken this with a telephoto lens, and nobody can actually go and try to chase the elephants away. So they stay for 12 hours during the daytime here. They don't do any feeding, or practically no feeding, unless there is some plants growing on the lake bed. And then come sunset, 6 p.m., they come out of the lake, they go and raid crops. And again, they go back to the lake. So there are these emergence of these new types of behaviors. The elephants are adapting to landscapes or habitats that are being shaped by humans. And that makes it very challenging to keep themselves away. And these elephants are males are doing it because, as I told you, they are following what I call a high strategy. They can grow larger in body size, they can come into musk, when they're feeding on all these nutritious crops. And then you see this little calf putting its trunk into the mouth of its mother and picking out a small bit of plant. It learns what is food and what is not food. So the same way, the family groups probably are teaching, you know, their son, daughters about crop raiding, especially if they are raiders themselves. Cultural transmission and learning going on. And that is something that perpetuates elephant conflict. Now, I'm just going to show you very quickly the satellite tracking of a male elephant to prove this point, that he's going specifically during two seasons, male season and paddy season for crops in North Bengal. Okay, this elephant, we put a GPS unit with a collar. We have given a narcotic to the elephant. It's down. Our team is collaring the elephant. The elephant is up. And this is West Bengal near the border with Bhutan, Bangladesh and Nepal and Assam on the other side. Okay, so in February, this elephant is named Raja. He's moving largely within the forest in the month of March. There is no crop, so he's largely within the forest. The yellow patches are the villages inside the forest. Now in May, the farmers cultivate maize. So the elephant is moving and inspecting the maize fields to see if he can raid crops. By June, the maize is ready to be harvested. He's coming back to the forest. And by August, he's retreated back into the forest. There's no crop at all. Then the farmers cultivate paddy. from village to village, and he is trying to, he's very directional kind of a movement as this elephant is showing. And then, you know, on the 31st of October, this elephant was just south of a village called Rajabhatkava. You see this little red square below. And then he suddenly showed a behavior which we never expected, inspiration. That really, I think, encapsulates the conflicts that prevailed between elephants and people, you know, in ancient India. Ganesha goes back to about 5th century of the common era, 1500 years old. So I'm just flashing this, you know, just to illustrate this. I'll just take now a few minutes. I'm not going to give you a long lecture of how do you mitigate conflicts. You know, we all want to solve conflicts. And it's not easy. You know, I hope you have understood all the different dimensions of the complexity and how whatever we try to do, the elephants usually try to overcome all our technologies. And I'm going to try and illustrate some of this. I'm not going to read through all of this, but I'll just illustrate. Chasing elephants. That's what people did, you know, right from the Sangam age to the present. You know, people sit up on, sometimes on watchtowers, sometimes on the ground, and they try to make noise and try to chase the elephants. Very, very dangerous, very dangerous. Just see this picture. This is taken near Hosur. You look at this elephant herd and look at the lead elephant. Look at her posture. Look at how she's watching that group of people, the villagers there. Look at her ears are flat, you know? This. And there is a very good chance that she might chase people and she might kill somebody. She might charge somebody. So this is, chasing is not necessarily very, very effective, you know? Elephant, you chase it away, it goes to your neighbor's field. That's it. The government sometime in the 1980s put in a lot of money all over the country in digging trenches, ditches, okay? Take bulldozers, you spend, you know, 5 lakhs, 10 lakhs per kilometer for digging these ditches. I never imagined that a ditch as deep as this, an elephant would try to get across this. The elephant could perform. Although I had watched elephants for many decades, till I saw this picture of an elephant performing a circus feat in clambering across the ditch. Okay, only then I realized that the elephant is capable of physical feats that we really can't imagine that an elephant is capable of. Just imagine, you know, very such a large-bodied animal. This female elephant clambering across could easily be, this actually a young male, sorry, who's got us, it's a young male elephant. This could easily be, you know, 2.5 tons or so, or maybe 3 tons. And how it's heaving itself across, you know, such a deep trench. Amazing, amazing. And therefore, the trenches become useful. Kerala and Karnataka, all these get washed away and the elephants can come. Then we have these electric fences. Okay, there's a little short video probably being. This is a high voltage electric fence. Elephants know that the soles of their feet are poor conductors. They know physics, you know, they have learned physics probably better than what physics I learned in my high school at least. And you see how the elephant is getting across an electric fence. This is a famous elephant called Ranga that eventually had to be captured because it was coming out and crossing the Bangalore-Mysore highway. It was going through a children's orphanage and so on and so forth. It had to be captured. So elephants overcome technology. They can think their way through a lot of problems. The tusks are poor conductors. They poke the wires. They push the fence post. You know, and some female elephants, they walk along the fence, locate a tree, and they push the tree over the fence. Elephants can pretty much overcome anything. They can think their way through any obstacles that we try to create. Okay. Ganesha, remember, is both a creator and a remover of obstacles. Very, very recently, maybe, you know, the hanging wire fence. The elephant has nothing to grasp. This is a picture taken with a night camera trap. Therefore, you can see on the top right, you can see those hanging wires being illuminated. A tuskless male elephant is approaching it. This is in Hosur forest division. Overcome this. They get a series of shocks. Very short pulse, you know, it's about 10,000 volts, but a millisecond duration. So we have to keep innovating all the time. But I can tell you the last 40 years, people have been trying to innovate and nothing has worked. Hopefully, these collars, GPS collars, as an early warning system. But all that you can do is you can capture an elephant, a troublemaker, you can put a collar, the data on a mobile app, I can actually track the movement. So can a forest officer. And if an elephant comes close to a village, he can, the guards can go and chase the elephants. Okay, but they still have to do the job of chasing the elephant. It's not very easy. Sometimes the capture might be inevitable. You know, this elephant called Chinnathambi, you may know the story better than I do. Elephants near Coimbatore town coming in regularly from the forests of Coimbatore. And they come at. So sometimes that might be no other option but to take an elephant into captivity. This is something we may have to put up with if we are to solve conflicts. And finally, this is my last slide. And that is that we have to plan at the scale of the landscape. We have to plan sustainable landscapes. We have to plan for corridors in a sensible way. We have to plan win-win situations for people and the elephant. And eventually, I think in the south, in southern India, I'm very optimistic because we have created conditions. You know, we have designed these Project Elephant landscapes starting about 30 years ago. And some of these areas, the forest cover has stabilized. The elephant population is very healthy. We have possibly the globally the largest Asian elephant population, you know, in the Nilgiris and Wayanad, Mysore Elephant Reserve. This is north of the Palghat Gap. The elephant is doing pretty well here. Of course, the irony of conservation is that, you know, other creatures also have benefited. The tiger has increased in population over the last 30 years because we have protected the habitat for the elephant. But at the same time, because of the conservation success, you know, some parts of Karnataka now elephants are coming out. They're going into coffee plantations in Kodagu and Hassan. They're creating a lot of problems. Elephants are coming out from Coimbatore town. Elephants from Hosur are going into Andhra. So a lot of challenges because of the success of conservation. But we need to eventually conserve elephants in partners and optimistic that in southern India, the elephant is going to survive, you know. I don't want to give you a pessimistic message at all because I've seen the elephant over the last 40 years. The elephant has great resilience. It's a creature which is a what we call a generalist species. It's got great resilience. It can adapt its behavior in manners that we can't even imagine. And I'm sure that 40, 50 years down the line, the elephant will continue to survive certainly in southern India. I can't say the same thing about the rest of the country, but certainly in southern India, the elephant will continue to survive. Thank you very much. And my last slide, of course, is this is my favorite elephant in art piece of all times, you know, a magnificent Pallava bas relief that I'm sure that most of you, if not all of you, have seen. The elephant is more realistic. You watch closely, you know, the little bulge between the ear, the eye and the ear, you see that little bulge. And it was really a master sculptor who sculpted this elephant. So bull in musk in consort with a female behind the little young elephants are there. This is my most favorite piece of art of depicting the elephant of all times. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah, I'm happy to take any questions if that allows. I'm going to not resume my presentation. Stop sharing, yes. Stop sharing, yeah. Thank you. Now to over to you all for questions if you have.
Sir, this is Shivakumar here. Quick question. So I could see a lot of the reserves in the Western Ghats. Any chance of they going to the Eastern Ghats to protect some?
See, your voice was breaking a little bit, but let me try and answer it from what I understood. You're talking about elephants in the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats. I know that Ghats has very few elephants. Most of the elephants in the Eastern Ghats are in Satyamangalam, Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary in that area. And then some elephants have gone into Andhra. You find elephants, a few elephants in Chittur. You find some elephants in Tirupati. And that's where you have right now the Eastern Ghats. Now, elephants in the, we have sufficient habitat for the elephants in the Western Ghats. The Western Ghats, especially the southern part, from about Talakaveri southward. Okay, I'm not so sure about elephants to the north of Talakaveri, but elephants to the south of Talakaveri, you have enough habitat. The forests are fairly intact. You have a vibrant population of elephants. And I would say that 98 or 99% of southern India's elephants are found there, south of Talakaveri. And there, the elephants are fairly safe. The habitats are consolidated. You have a lot of protected areas, large populations, more than 8,000 elephants north of the Palghat Gap. South of the Palghat Gap, you have another 6,000 in two or three populations. You have Anamalai, Neliampathis, you have Periyar, Srivilliputtur, and you have Agastya Malai, south of the Shenkota Gap. Now you come to the Eastern Ghats. Elephants have been going in the Eastern Ghats, Tirupati. Now it's not a viable population. The numbers are small, you know, 12, 15 elephants. Eventually, the only place where there might be viable habitat in the Eastern Ghats is the Nagarjuna Sagar, what we call the Nagarjuna Sagar, Tiger Reserve area. So elephants are eventually able to reach there. They're quite far away. But the problem is, if elephants reach that far, it will come with a lot of pain. It will come with a lot of conflict. That's an area where you have a lot of tribal populations, subsistence farmers. I've been to the area. It's, there used to be a lot of extremist movements in that area in the past. And there will be a lot of conflict. So if you were to ask me my personal opinion, we should be satisfied with the Project Elephant Reserves that were declared, you know, south of the Talakaveri, Eastern Ghats up to Bannerghat. Thank you.
Dr. Sukumar, I'm Narayana, retired from the Department of Wildlife and JVC College. Hello.
No, actually,
I am actually listening about and also talking about the lantana problem for the more than four decades. And now the park managers also find it very difficult to approve or to control the lantana. And still, have you achieved in the controlling the lantana, whatever we have that? What is your experience in that? Or what is it you advocate for the park manager to maintain or to, what is it feasible to have this program approving a lantana? What's your topic?
Okay. See, again, I wish we had simple solutions. You know, everything is complex in life. The most recent, of course, being the COVID-19, you know, which has thrown all science and everything out of the window. But coming to lantana specifically, see, what I will say is that lantana has been around for a long time. The big expansion of lantana in the south recently came about 15 years ago. And I have written papers about it. I have published papers about it along with my students. When you talk about uprooting, there is a particular method of uprooting lantana. You should not indiscriminately simply go and cut lantana. If you cut it, it will start coppicing. If it coppices, then it becomes even tougher to uproot lantana, to move lantana. You have to uproot it. Uproot it, and just below the surface, root, the growing shoot, its meristem, it's called in botanical terms, it's called the meristematic tissue. You have to make a You have to cut it about 2-3 centimeters or 1 inch below the ground, and you have to uproot the whole lantana. Okay, that's the first part. The department, sometimes what happens in a hurry, they are in a hurry, they simply go and just cut. It was totally useless, it is counterproductive. The second point is that lantana fruits are eaten by bulbul, and the bulbuls fly, you know, a few hundred meters, they disperse the seeds. So you go to a patch of lantana and remove it. Now the bank of the soil, they start coming, growing. So what recommendations that we have made is as follows. What we find is lantana starts spreading from streams and river courses. So what we say, you start your lantana control from your, you take a landscape. You should have a specific plan. You should not haphazardly go anywhere and then try to cut lantana. Cut lantana, it will not work. You start from the stream banks. You uproot the lantana there. you would, Mudumala, you go to wilds like the swampy area because you want to maintain the grassland there. And then you start creating these zones or buffers where maybe something like a radius of 1 kilometer, you keep it free of antenna. That should be larger than the dispersal distance of bulbuls flying and depositing the seed. You understood the point? So that new seeds will not come into that area and establish. And then start with that and then keep expanding. So that then you will start creating these core areas where lantana has cleared and there is no further seed or bulbuls cannot fly and come and deposit the seeds there. So there has to be a method in the madness of clearing lantana. It can be done, but I think that we are largely reconciled to keeping it under control. Total eradication is not going to be possible. Nice to see you after many years. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, just email me, I'll send you the papers.
Okay.
Doctor, I have a question about this. As you said, the lantana removal, exactly what you're saying, is what we're trying to do in the Medagris. We found where we remove lantana, we are being overtaken by Parthenium.
Right.
Okay, as an obvious thing comes down. Yeah, so that is one problem, and that doesn't help anything anyway. Then you put the Parthenium and then you come to the next thing. My question was a little bit more radical. One of the thoughts was that, you know, you have the forest, you're trying to remove lantana, where it's very, very thick growth, you need to use, you cannot do this cutting process because it's so thick to even enter and clear, especially if there's a forest fire and you're not dealt with it. But if we could get around to removing it and creating, replacing with appropriate trees and grasses, you still have the problem of cattle grazing, which then becomes a secondary problem, which brings in other trees. The question really is, would it in the long term make sense to put in the kind of crops that these guys go out to raid along the buffer zone?
Are you seeing Asian Elephant Specialist Group? We have been going through a lot of discussion on the so-called fodder plantations for elephants and so on. I'll not get into that. I don't think those things will work. But coming to your point about grasses and so on, see, inside a forest like a national park like Mudumalai, if you are replacing it with grasses, it's absolutely fine because, you know, there is no cattle grazing inside, pretty much. So the grasses are likely to come. In fact, let me tell you, when I told you about the expansion of lantana starting around 2004-05, it's a complex issue. Climate variability played a role, a drought played a role. I'll not get into the details, but essentially, following it, if you're able to reseed the grasses and bring the grasses back, then there is a good chance that lantana might be suppressed to a certain extent. See, what we need is, we need experimental ecology. This is something that we are very reluctant to do in our country. You know, we don't, you know, and there are many other countries where people do experimental ecology. We need to look at soil nutrient cycling. We need to try out a lot of different methods and persist for 10 years at least before we can come up with clear restrictions. But we need to start this process as early as possible. Thank you.
Sir, good evening. This is Sharavanan.
Yes.
Sir, I have a couple of questions. I've been a long time working on captive elephants and I'm more with wildlife also, with associated with impact. I have been coming across some articles that was even published in, they were developing some kind of plantain variety called Bhimkol and elephant grasses to be done somewhere in Assam. And a friend of mine was being, Raj Pookan was also working on that. And they were telling that they have found some very good results over that. Could it be a better reason to develop it somewhere, some feeding points?
Right. See, as I told you, over the last 3 or 4 days, there's been a discussion in the Asian Elephant Specialist Group of IUCN on precisely this point. The point I'm trying to make is, there isn't one common solution for everything. The problem is so widespread. you can have a local solution for a given farmer or a small group of farmers. Okay, I would certainly encourage that. But don't think that there's a panacea for solving different human conflicts across the whole of India. It's not possible. Okay. In fact, a number of very pragmatic people have actually expressed their opinions within the specialist group recently. And these are things that will not work in the long term. It can work in the short term. It can work on a very, very local scale and so on and so forth. People try, you know, beehives, you know, the so-called bee fencing. You know, I'm just going off the track a little bit. But I remember 10 years ago when I went to Africa, people told me that African bees were being used, you know, to drive African elephants away. And they asked me, why don't you try it in India, in Asia? So I told them one thing. I said, our Asian elephants are more aggressive than your African elephants, or Asian elephant. And our Asian bees are less aggressive than your African bees. African bees are extremely aggressive. And therefore, it will not work in Asia. Well, nevertheless, many Western scientists came and they did experiments and so on. And they actually find out all these things have not worked. It all miserably fails. But, you know, can you imagine there are hundreds of thousands of farmers? Everybody cannot be using beehives or whatever. So we need to think of something, solutions that can be scaled up on a larger scale, can provide more long-lasting solutions. But having said that, there are simple solutions on the ground. Like, let's say I have a little farm, let us say, okay, I pay, you know, an elephant comes in. I play through a loudspeaker, I play the sound of a tiger growling. An elephant may run away. But there's no guarantee that that elephant will not learn. After some time, this is like the boy who cried wolf. Elephant learns, there's no tiger around. And one week later, he'll start coming back and he will say, okay, now you want playing your tiger sounds? You know, let me see what you can do. Right? Elephant is a very, very intelligent creature. It's not easy. I'm not discouraging those experiments, but you know, my gut feeling is they work on a very, very small scale. The there's a complexity in terms of the elephant distribution, land use patterns across India that prevent all this from working. Yeah. Sorry for the long answer. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, Dr. Sukumar. Thank you.
We did the anchoring for Government of India. So we are engaged in a variety of different projects. We are now trying to see, we did a study of elephants being killed by railway, by train accidents in North Bengal. And there are some agencies like Asian Development Bank and others who are interested in using our services to come up with actual solutions to try to prevent elephants from being hit by trains. So basically, it's a conservation wing of what I do, essentially. Asian Nature Conservation Foundation. And our website is undergoing some changes and all that. But if you click on it, you will still get it. We'll very quickly revamp, hopefully, over the next month or so. We'll get a really good website. But our older website is still there. It is called, just ancf.org. Sanjay? Yeah, it's there. AsianNature.org.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Yeah, I should also tell you that when you all talk about elephant corridors, I can tell you that about a dozen corridors in the country that have been set up formally. Okay, I have played a role in almost every single corridor, starting from the first one in Bandipur, going back to 2000 or 2001, and up to almost the most recent one, possibly in West Bengal. And I worked both through ANCF and also another big NGO called Wildlife Trust of India, based in Noida. It's much better known. I kept my NGO relatively small. But and these are the only corridors that have been strengthened in the country. So NGO, all because of NGOs. Yeah, sorry, go ahead, please.
Yeah, good evening, sir. This is Bhuminathan. So excellent presentation from you, as
thank
usual.
You.
So, yes, sir. So this is regarding the Lantana invasive species. And there are talks around the forest fire is an integral part of the habitat, and once the forest fires are being controlled more areas, so you are the right person to answer, because I know you are also having a 50 hectare plot in Mudumalai for long period monitoring.
Yeah,
and the vegetation dynamics, kindly, please.
I think Bhupinathan has brought up a very, again, a very important issue, namely that of forest fires. And here again, there are a lot of, you know, kind of more, I would call them run-of-the-mill or pedestrian kind of understanding of it, by and large in the media, public imagination, there should be no fire at all. Fire is an integral part of ecosystems, the drier ecosystems of the of this world. And panel on climate change, on global forest fires and so on. But coming specifically to this question, you know, I wrote an article in Economic and Political Weekly. The first author is Tash Takekara, where we actually made out a case why we should take traditional knowledge systems of the tribals. See, unfortunately, what has happened is our indigenous people, whether it's in Australia or India or parts of Africa or even North America, they have been managing the land in a certain fashion over a long period. Developed a certain knowledge system. But these indigenous knowledge systems have been completely replaced by what I may say European knowledge systems. I'm just deliberately using the word European knowledge systems, because it has been shown that when Europeans went and colonized Australia, when Europeans went and colonized North America and so on, they changed the land use systems, they discarded indigenous knowledge and all of that. Now, one of the tools that humans have used is use of fire. And over the years now, if you see, that because of strict protection from forest fires, the various species have started coming in. This includes lantana. We have failed to use fire as a tool early in the dry season to set light fires, low temperature, low destructive kind of fires, fires that are not very destructive, and then manage the forest. That's how the tribals were managing the forest. We have replaced that with a strict protection system, and we are suffering as a result. And these are knowledge systems that we refuse to accept, you know, because after all, what we are tribals, you know, we are scientists, we are conservationists, you know, we are from the cities, and therefore our knowledge systems are far superior. Let me tell you, on ecosystem services and the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the latest assessments are now devoting a lot of attention to how indigenous communities have coped with climate change and what is it that we can learn from them. So Bhupinathan is absolutely right. We need to bring in fire as a tool in management of our forests, actually set fire to the forest to save the forest. Okay, I'll not elaborate on it. I can give a separate talk on fires, but I can give it.
Thank you.
Yes.
No, you have to unmute, ma'am. You have to unmute.
Yeah. The co-convener of Chennai chapter, I think we are reaching the sort of the 1.5 hour limit, but I want to congratulate you on your talk, and while your the title was sort of, what should I say, sort of curious, and we wondered what your talk would be all about. I think you've gone well beyond what was, you know, that an action with all species and especially elephants, as you said in your talk. But I am going to ask you a question, which we had a talk about 3 weeks ago on the new draft environmental impact assessment notification. So I thought I'll put you on the spot and ask you about your views on. I think everywhere people are very concerned about it, and whatever you have said so far, including your most comments about traditional knowledge, about learning from you know, indigenous communities and trying to be a little more modest about how we should approach things. I would ask you to just tell us as NGOs and others what environmental impact assessment, because we are now, it is in the court, and we are, how do we convince our governments to be...
The environmental impact assessment, the draft itself is something that I must confess that I have not fully studied. I've been getting a lot of representations myself. I sit on various committees of Government of India, not the environmental impact assessment part, but there are other committees. And therefore, what I would say is certainly we should be concerned about dilution of environmental norms. At the same time, you know, I think, you know, this really poses a much broader question of the future of humanity as a whole in relation to what our real needs are. In terms of consumption of resources, I mean, I see the problems of this world because I work on climate change. I'm very closely associated with climate change research. And at the heart of the problem of climate change is in consumption of energy. Of course, you know, people talk about population growth, but we know now that human populations have started stabilizing pretty much around the world. And over a period of time, the human population will actually go and it will be people. So that might be good news in some respects, maybe not in others, but energy consumption. As long as all of us want to consume more and more energy, there is, and unless you find, I'm just giving a very, very broad answer at this stage. Unless you find a source of energy that is limitless, okay, and coal fusion was, I'm not a physicist, but coal fusion was something that, the splitting of water and liberation of energy from that, but that's, you know, not yet seen the light of day. People talk about solar energy. We definitely need to move in that direction. I think India is going quite rapidly in the direction of renewables and bioenergy. Many other countries like Germany and Britain have gone in that direction. That's a direction we should go under. So I see this possibly as a temporary phase where, you know, a certain amount of development. People like us, to the extent that we can, when we are in committees, we try to see to the extent possible conditions. We see if possible some of the projects don't get through, or they get through, the environment is not harmed to a great extent, and so on and so forth. But I think the whole the environment versus development debate is too large for me to answer it in two or three sentences. But yes, I mean, make your representations to the government. I was really busy in the last few weeks. I was close to my retirement, as I told you last week. And you know, post that, I've been getting a lot of representations. Just starting to understand that, you know, I'm sure that some of the clauses that they have proposed is something we should oppose. But I don't think we should oppose necessarily every single clause, you know, just because if the government is asking for a revision or whatever else it is. Yeah. So I'll stop with that. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Sukumar, again for an excellent speech. For an excellent talk that taught us a lot about elephants and their food habits. And you talked about marula fruit, I think, that elephants eat, and because it's an intox that the taste buds of the elephant are actually reflected in the form of the satisfied Ganesha. And I think, thank you very much. It was an excellent talk. Thank you so much for the trouble and effort that you took. And I'm sure we can have a whole session on Lantana soon, because I know how much people worry about Lantana. Those who have estates, forests, and other things. The only thing is we at INTACT have been talking about the importance of traditional knowledge and how it is ignored by authorities and administrators. somewhere along the way we find that those who try to take indigenous knowledge or traditional knowledge are actually business houses, and so it commercial interests are exploiting, I won't even say exploiting, are cornering the traditional knowledge, whereas it should come into the common domain and should be used for public good. I'm sure that would be your viewpoint as well, and let's hope that it'll happen soon. Thank you very much, and thank you everybody. Would like.
Thanks to Intact for inviting me, and especially to Sujata. I can give you we can have a separate session on Lantana, one on fire, and one exclusively on Ganesha on Monday.
So, thank you all for joining this meeting, and hope to see you all soon. I don't know what the next talk is, but I'm sure Sujata will tell us and conclude this session.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. Just add to what Tara said. We have two talks coming up next week. We have on August 12th, which is Library Day, an overview of libraries of Madras. And on August 13th, which is next Thursday, we have a talk by Dr. Devika on Gandhi in continuation with the 150th year talks that we start here, and we got locked down, so we're just reviving that on the online platform, hopefully for wider reach. Thank you so much to everyone for joining, and thank you, Dr. Sukumar, for an inspiring evening. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I wish I had been there in person, but maybe one day.
That didn't happen for several years, so we are happy it happened online.
Thank you. Bye. Take care, everyone. Take care, everyone.
Yes, take care and stay safe, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It's a wonderful talk.